Good afternoon, good afternoon, and good afternoon. How are you guys? How's everything? I hope all of you are doing great. Well, first off, most of you are complaining that screen needs to be flipped because that's turning wrong. Nikon is written up like other way around. Well, I did fix it. I tried to fix it through the Facebook mirror option. But basically it's distorting the framing. Whenever I try to mirror before I go in Facebook Live, it basically distorting the whole frame. So unfortunately, I cannot do anything. I really apologize for that. That's something I cannot fix. It's the Facebook glitch. It's a Facebook issue. Whenever I try to mirror to make it readable for you guys, it's not going to help because it's going to distort the frame. That's Facebook glitch. You can check it. I tried it from iPad, from iPhone. It's the same. The end result is the same. Anyways, so what we are going to talk? We are going to talk about this thing. Yesterday, I did a very long video about the Nikon D850, and I name it as a living legend, which it is. And on that video, I did introduce a little bit of D500. So we are going to talk about D500 today. This is something which many people underestimated for a very long time. Still people underestimating this machine. When this machine was announced, I was thrilled because the people who cannot afford machine like D5 or D4S or high-end sports action wildlife machines, those people can enjoy the same, almost like 95% of the stuff, except high ISO. So rest of the feature like autofocus tracking, autofocus acquisition. Acquisition is about the lens, tracking is based on the camera. So the autofocus tracking and all these autofocus features, especially which are mostly comes at the price of the high-end machine. It comes with the high-end machine. You can have 95% or 90% all those features into this small little body at one third of the price. So that's what it is. It's a crop sensor camera which gives you the same level of details like D850. Why? Because it has the same number of megapixels per square millimeter, just like D850. So if you take a shot from D850 using the same lens and you use the same lens on this body, you zoom in D850 and D500 files to 100%, they both will be identical in terms of details. You will get the same details from D850 and D500. So D500, yesterday I talked about D850 and I mentioned that when it comes to bird photography, when it comes to action, wildlife photography, that's where the D500 has an advantage over D850. Why? Because of very basic reasons. First reason, it's got the deeper buffer, up to 200 frames. This machine can go up to like, you can name it. It has the XQD card slot, so which goes more, and then one SD, which is two. So that can So you can shoot up to 200 frames. That's the buffer. It's got a much more deeper buffer than D850. Second thing is you need D850 as 5 frames per second seven frames per second. With battery grip, you can extend it to 9 frames per second. This without battery grip can go 10 frames per second by default. Even I can shoot it right now. I can show it to you. Continuous high, that's it. Check this out. See, I just stopped because I have the slow speed SD card and I am copying in both identical. That's why the buffer fills up. But if you are shooting at continuous XQD, 200 frames, JPEG, straight away, no question asked. Next, this comes with D5 autofocus algorithm and also the autofocus module that was used in Nikon D5, it has the same. So you can expect it's not going to perform less than D5. Well, but of course, D5 is a high-end machine. Its autofocus mechanism tuned to the top performance. This machine is crop sensor, so its performance is a little bit slow, or you can say a little bit down when it comes to D5. Imagine this. You have Lamborghini Gallardo. It comes with V10, 5.7 liter engine, V10. Lamborghini Gallardo. The same engine was used in Audi S8. Same engine. But when Audi S8 and Lamborghini Gallardo, which carries the same engine, 5.7 liter V10, when you go for both, Lamborghini always excel. Why? Because its aerodynamic shape, it's got faster, you know, tracking and faster torque and all those things which comes to, when it comes to design, the body was tuned for fast acceleration in compared to S8 of Audi. So imagine this analogy exactly applies for D5 and D500. So same engine, but their performance is little bit tweaked when it comes to autofocus tracking and autofocus tracking. Because when it comes to autofocus acquisition is based on the lens. Tracking is based on the camera. So when you are try to acquire focus on anything, especially bird, action, sports, the acquisition of the focus is mostly related to lens. Of course, it requires camera body to drive that focus acquisition, but how fast the motor inside that lens is totally dependent on the lens. Of course, you need push from the body. So this body is much more faster in driving all those things, but still you need a lens to go for. It's just like that. You have two lens which have one is a slow motor, another is fast motor to acquire the focus, and you use both those lenses on D500. So obviously with the lens with faster acquisition will respond much more quickly and grab the focus for you. So it's just like that. Like I have Nikon D300. I have a Nikon D300 f2.8. That lens is old, but its motor inside of that lens is much more faster than any other modern day camera or modern day lens, which is like f4, 5.6. I have 200 to 500, 5.6. It's a slow lens in compared to 300 2.8, because 300 2.8 has much more faster motor to focus, and I use both lens on this. 300 2.8 always acquire the same always acquire the focus faster than 200 to 500 5.6. so that's the acquisition. Now when it comes to tracking, this tracking is the same. I compared this D500 with D780. I use the same lens, which was Nikon 200 to 500, and I use that 200 to 500 on D500, and I use the same 200 to 500 on Nikon D780, which is right on there on the table. I cannot grab it right now. So when I use the same lens on D500 and D780, the D500 acquired the focus and track the focus much more faster, approximately 200 to 300 milliseconds, something like that, much more faster than D780. So you can see this machine is basically designed, it's built for sports, action, wildlife. Don't expect this machine to give you the landscape. Of course, it has an excellent dynamic range. I have used it, tested it, and it's amazing. It's better than Nikon D7200. I thought D7200 was really good, 14.1 EV of dynamic range, but this one excel, 14.5 I believe it's dynamic range at lower ISOs. So I am just trying to tell you those things which I have experienced for D500, which you haven't seen in the normal specs. My videos is all about those things and those information which you haven't experienced, you haven't seen or nobody have talked about. So D500, when it comes to sports, action, wildlife, this machine is a dream. It's a dream. It's much cheaper and it gives you all those features like D500. It gives you all the things which you want to go for: sports, action, bird photography, wildlife photography, sports journalism. Another advantage of this is autofocus points. Now this autofocus points, 153 autofocus points, is not like central which you normally seen in the DSLR, which you are centrally congested. This 153 autofocus points is literally up to here, edge to edge. So anything from this edge all the way to this edge, you can track that. This is what you can get from D500. So if you are trying to capture bird action or any sports action, tracking of cheetah, you know, going after its prey, you can track entire frame edge to edge, which you cannot in D850, which you cannot in D5, which you cannot in D4S. This is where this machine excels, because you literally track the entire subject from this edge of the frame to this edge of the frame. The entire autofocus points are spread. That's the beauty of D500. You cannot get that thing in any of the DSLR. That's the thing. So that's why there's people who know what this machine is all about and who know what kind of tool it is and you can go for, they're using it. For it is dedicatedly built for sports action wildlife. It is designed like that. Another thing, it's a high ISO capability. When I first started using it, I thought, oh, okay, at 5000 ISO, 6400 ISO, I'm getting grains. I was like, I'm getting grains. But here is the thing. I shot that thing at in certain lighting condition up to 22,000 ISO. Yeah, I believe it was 22,000 ISO. Image was clean. All the images were usable. You can go up to 40,000 ISO easily. Like in a condition where you doesn't need much to apply the noise filtration, you can use up to 40,000 ISO. No question asked. By the way, there are things inside all the Nikon DSLRs which is called high ISO noise reduction, which is a built-in feature of every Nikon DSLR or even for mirrorless. If you enable that, it has five levels, I believe three or five levels: small, medium, high, extra high. So by choosing all those different values, you can suppress the noise. Of course, it will trade off some quality of the image. Image won't be as sharp as it's supposed to be when you are going to enable that high ISO noise reduction. So what that feature does is, if you are shooting at 20,000 ISO, it will reduce the noise, but also the corner of the image is not going to be sharp, because the noise reduction algorithm softens the edges of the subject that you have shot. So most people who really want like crystal sharp images, they always disable that feature. What I do is I shot quickly and I realized that in this kind of scenario, I will be shooting at high ISO. So instead of going high value of the noise reduction, I always choose lowest one, little bit. So I am trying to reduce the noise, but also maintaining the quality of the subject at the same time. So I put that thing as a shortcut in my camera. By the way, that camera comes with very handy features. Of course, it can make 4K at 30 frames, but I'm not a video guy, so don't expect me to say anything. It doesn't have the pop-up flash, doesn't need, because in sports action wildlife, don't need. It has the tilted screen, but it's not touch-based, so it's not a touch screen. All right. I don't want to go through all this technical stuff because you can find on YouTube anywhere you like. I'm more concerned about this autofocus thing. Let me show you something. Wait. Yeah. Okay. Check this out. I hope you will. Wait. You see? The edge-to-edge autofocus points. You seeing this? No other camera offer this thing, edge-to-edge autofocus points. This is the only camera which can help you. Let me show you again. You see this? So these are edge-to-edge autofocus point for D500. By the way, you can configure. You go into the menu, then go to custom setting menu, then go to controls, and then go to F1. The menu is F1. In this F1 menu, basically you can configure a lot. All those things, all those buttons you can configure for D500. You can configure all these buttons and you can do a lot from all these. The menu is F1. You can see this over here, F1. So F1 menu is basically where you can play with autofocus system and you can do a hell lot of it. So for the bird photographer, action photographer, wildlife photographer, this machine is like, damn. You give this machine a lens and you just sit back and let this machine do the job. 20 megapixel, which is equal to volume slam motion. How are you? 20 megapixel, which is equal to 46 megapixel of full frame. And it's one tough machine. One tough machine. Wait. Let's see how much buffer it can go with. I am going to configure quality to right. Okay, let's see. 10 frames per second, all right? See? How much you can you do that with your D850? Of course not. You cannot. You just can't. This machine is, the tagline of this machine is need for speed. Yep, that's how I can relate. Need for speed. You give this machine the lens and the fastest card, and you just sit back and let this machine do the job. Yeah, I wasted some frames for you guys just to show you what this machine is all about. So I'm going to wrap up now because this machine, it's all about fast action paced photography at budget level. If you cannot afford D4S, D4, or D5, especially D5, then you go with this machine and you will be a happy camper. It has the same autofocus module like D5, but it's driving algorithms. It's not like D5, it's slower than D5. So it's just like I just mentioned into the example that it does have the same engine of autofocus module like D5, but I gave you the example earlier that Lamborghini Gallardo has 5.7 liter V10 engine, which is also the same engine which you have in Audi S8. So both car, Audi S8 and Lamborghini Gallardo, both have 5.7 liter V10 engine, right? But when it comes to acceleration and the long run, this Lamborghini Gallardo always excels. Why? Because of body dynamics, aerodynamic shape of the body, unlike the Audi S8. So there is always, even you have the same engine, but there is always a difference in performance based on other parameters. So this is exactly applies over here for D5 versus D500. Both have the same autofocus module, right? But the software which driving that autofocus module in D5 is top of the line. In D500 is little less. Just like the example I gave you for Lamborghini Gallardo and Audi S8. So I'm going to wrap up this video now by saying this, all these features of D500 versus D850 or D5. Basically, this machine is built for give you the more details without having long lenses, without going for long lenses, because of 20 megapixel, which is equal to 46 megapixel for full frame. So people who are shooting with D850 and they think that they will get more details from D850 there, which they cannot get from any other camera, they are idiots actually. I'm sorry, but that's the case. Because D850, the number of pixels per square millimeter, and D850 is the same like D500. I just mentioned this before. You take the shot from D500, you take the shot from D850, same distance, same lens, you zoom to 100%, both images will be identical in terms of details. But people don't understand that. They always think, oh, D850 is good. No, D500 is equally good. It's just that it's more compact, smaller in size than D850, and it's without needing battery grip, it can go 10 frames per second. D850 requires battery grip to go 9 frames per second. So, which is better, this or D850, which requires battery grip? This doesn't require battery grip, but still can go 10 frames per second. It has a much more deeper buffer than D850. Now, people who love D850, they don't want to hear these kind of facts, which I understand. But this is the fact. D500 is always got upper hand on D850 in terms of everything when it comes to sports, action, wildlife, bird photography. Technically, I already proved it. Statically, I already proved it. Rest is up to you. All the advantage, all the points goes into D500 favor, not into D850. Yes, D850 is built for all-purpose machine, which it is. D500 is not all-purpose. It's not. If I have this lens, that's 17-55 2.8 DX lens. 17-55 2.8 DX lens. I use this lens all the time on this machine. D500 to capture some street photography stuff. Normal, this is the best lens for DX. I already made a video of it. I uploaded at VUEGRAPHY, the YouTube channel, VUEGRAPHY, VUEGRAPHY. I already uploaded that video, the best DX lenses for your crop sensor at VUEGRAPHY. Do check it out. This lens is in that list. So I use this lens on D500 all the time. That's my normal go-to lens. But of course, D500 is not paid for landscape. Of course, you can do landscape, but you cannot get that quality, right? That's where D850 kicks in, D850 excels. This, for wildlife, sports action, you can take street photography, you can take images for street photography and landscape and portrait. You can do that, but at what cost? At what cost? This is the thing. this is not the right tool for sports action wildlife. Oh, sorry, landscape portrait. This is the best tool for fast action genre photography. So that's the bottom line. Anyways, thank you so much for watching, and keep watching this space, and I'll get online often and give you more tips, more inside information about the gears that we are having from Nikon or any other. Unfortunately, I am kind of a Nikon guy, so I develop my skills over Nikon gears, but I would love to hear from other people who are Canon shooter, who are Sony shooter, who are Fujifilm shooter. I would love to hear from them, so they make such videos like I do. I am not making high-end videos for YouTube. I just here to share the information in very raw format, so that's why my videos are like this. I don't do any editing and stuff. I just record it, post it, record, post. Don't have time for editing. But I would love to hear from the other guys if they want to share Canon expertise, Sony expertise, and they can come and post at VUE anytime they want. Everybody is welcome at VUE. Thank you. Stay home, stay safe.